Okay, so that tells you like kind of like the basic idea of how we're going to represent this. So right now I'm going to talk about a very specific format, the variant call format. It gets used in a lot of different things. So basically what this is there's a large number of comments at the beginning, header lines is what we call them, that all start with a hashtag. So we're just going to ignore those for now. And then each line in the rest of the file represents one variant. So that's one position in the genome that's known to have different alleles possible for it. So you can see here the very first one in this example is on chromosome 20. It's at position 14,370, so that's base pairs. And it has an ID, RS6054257. I did not need to say that out. So RS IDs are what this kind of ID is called. And so those are found online in some databases. DBSNP is one that you might want to check out. So basically, we've got the RS ID, we've got the reference and the alternate alleles. You can see these two are triallelic, just like you were talking about. See, there's GTCT, there's G, or there's GTACT. And then do you want me to talk about the other fields, or do you want to just move on?
No, it just zooms in on the next one.
Okay. Oh, it zooms in. Okay, yeah. So this is the part that we care about. So we've got the reference allele. Remember, that's referring to the human genome reference. So whatever you use to create your VCF file will change what we consider the reference sometimes. And then we've got a quality score, don't worry too much about that. The filter, don't worry too much about that. A lot of times when I'm making VCFs, I just put dots for these because I don't care that much. And then there's usually an info block, which is defined, each one of these elements is defined in the header lines. So does everyone understand these first 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 fields? What they mean. That's basically just what we were showing before with the haplotype matrix. Okay, so let's go back to talking about the header lines. So as you can
question.
See. Yeah. Oh, so, no, sorry, Nico.
If you have two alternates, are you, when you're counting in like the later columns, would you just count how many of either alternate you have? Or?
So it gets complicated. I'm not sure if we talk about that here.
It's shown in the VCF.
Okay, yeah.
But in general, if you're ever doing research, one of the first steps you're going to do is just get to remove anything that's not biallelic.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just because there's the probability of your mutation happening at any one point is 10 times 10 to the negative 8, which is really small. And so if you have like a SNP, the probability of having another mutation at that same position in the SNP to create a triallelic thing is like 10 million or something, 100 million, whatever that is. And so like, there are so few that we just decided we're just not going to care about them. And that works really well 99.9% of the time.
Yeah.
So most people just remove them. There are some people who are doing work with that, but like those three triallelic SNPs that I found in my research recently that I was telling you about, I just removed them. So I found them and I removed them. Anyway, so here you can see they're using the NCBI36 reference genome, which is the last reference genome that was created by the Human Genome Project. And it's also the reference for something called 1,000 genomes, the first initial study of it. So what they did is they genotyped 1,000 people. Now they've got 1,000 people from lots of different backgrounds. But yeah, you might hear people talk about 1,000 genomes. That's what it is. So you can tell what the reference is. Usually they should have this reference line. If they don't, it will cause you a great deal of pain trying to figure out what reference they were using. Phasing, you can see partial means that they were only able to phase some of the genotypes here. So they were only able to figure out which parent has which SNP or variant at some of the locations in this VCF file. And then these info fields tell you what these things in the info down here represent. So you can see here, ID is NS. So the part that says NS equals 3. NS should be a number. It should only be one time. It is an integer, right? And then the description is the number of samples within data, okay? So for all of the samples that we are genotyping in this particular file, there are three. Does that make sense, NS? Sometimes you'll combine genotyping results from multiple different sequencing runs. And so because of that, because of that, you might have different NS for different lines in it. Because some of them might have genotyped one variant, some of them might not have. So. And then we've got total depth, right? So that's the read depth, the number of reads that cover that position. Don't worry too much about that. We'll talk about it in a later module. An important one that Rob wanted me to point out is the allele frequency and the ancestral allele. So in this VCF file, they have an info field for what the ancestral allele is. So that can be really useful when you're trying to do stuff that requires you to know that. Does that make sense? So if you see something under the info column that you don't know what it is, look up to the header and it should be defined. They don't always do that correctly, but it should be. And then let's move on to the format lines. So format is here. The format tells you what to expect for the remaining columns. So in a VCF, you have these first 9 columns that are required. And then you can have as many columns after that as you want that will each represent one person. Does that make sense? So you remember when we were looking back at the genotype matrix? That's kind of what we're doing here. We've got all of this information at the beginning, and then we have a bunch of columns. Each one represents one person and their genotype at this position. That makes sense? So the format tells us what the numbers underneath that person mean. So this one says GT, GQ, DP, and HQ. And each one is separated by colons. So if we look at the format field, it tells us GT stands for genotype. And GQ stands for genotype quality. And DP stands for read depth. So that's the thing I was talking about before. And then HQ is haplotype quality. So then when we look at, is it bigger on the next one? Yeah. So when we look at each of these individuals, 0 is the genotype, right? And then in this VCF, they've chosen to do it so that you have the genotype and then a bar and then the genotype field again.
No, that's the phase genotype.
Oh, it's the phase genotype.
That's the phase genotype.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Usually they don't work with phase genotypes, so I'm like, what? So they've got 0, 0, right? So from one parent they got the reference and from the other parent they got the reference. This individual has 1, 0. So from one parent, they got the alternate allele and from the other parent, they got the reference allele. Does that make sense? And then these additional components after the colons, so GQ, genotype quality, that's a quality metric. 1, DP, that's the read depth, so only one read was covering that position, etc. Does that make sense for everyone? Do you know where you would look if you're looking at a VCF now to try to figure out what things mean? Any questions so far? Yes.
Clarify the slashes mean unphased?
Yes, exactly. Good job. Thanks for remembering that from last time. Yeah. So the pipe means that it's been phased. Slashes mean that it's unphased. And remember, in the header it said partially phased. That's why it says partially phased, because there's only, like, there's some variants that were not phasable on each individual. And you can see that's because this one is a complex one, so that's going to be really difficult. Yes?
So you usually create these files after you do, like, sequencing or what? Genotyping,
yeah. So basically, if you do genotyping with a SNP chip or if you do sequencing of the whole genome, you want to figure out where the variants are. So you'll do variant finding in different ways, and then this will be your output for your genotypes. Does that make sense? So with SNP chip, it's easy because you're looking specifically at these variants, so the output of that already is kind of like this. With sequencing, it's a bit harder. But.
Also, on that one, you can see the very bottom line is a triallelic variant. So you can see here, like the 0, 1, there's also this option as a 2, and that just means you have the second of the alleles listed.
That's actually pretty standard. So if you have multiple alleles, instead of just having 0 for the reference and 1 for the alternate, you'll have 0 for the reference still, and then you'll have 1, 2, 3, etc. for the other in the order that it's written. So here they wrote G, GTACT. So G is 1, GTACT is 2. I don't think you'll have to deal with that, but that's just in case you want to know. Okay, so a great thing that wasn't super popular when I first started doing this kind of work, and has become really useful, is that you don't have to manipulate these on your own anymore very much. So there's these tools called VCF tools and BCF tools. So BCF stands for binary VCF. So that's exactly what you were talking about, where these are going to be compressed files because they're pretty easy to compress. So VCF tools and BCF tools manipulate, filter, and extract information from these files. That makes sense? So there's a lot of software that takes a VCF file as its input. There's a lot of software that takes it, that gives the VCF file as its output. And so you can use VCF tools and BCF tools to manipulate these files, and you don't have to do any actual like command line looking at each line in the file and changing it yourself. That's actually a really great way to screw up your data. So, okay, so in conclusion, we have lots of ways of representing alleles that we have in our genotypes. And many of them require you to have a reference genome, which we learned what it is. And it is great to refer to the alleles as numbers instead of the letters for reasons of storage.